Good morning. Welcome to Arlington Street Church, gathered in love and service for justice and peace. Welcome to the soul of Sunday. We are Unitarian Universalists. Ours is a historic faith with a progressive theology. We affirm the worth and dignity of every being, and that we are all deeply interconnected. We are bound to one another, not by creed, but by covenant. And we are called to answer the call of love with open minds, open hearts, and open hands. Whoever you are, those of all nations, all creeds, all colors, all kinds of love, you are welcome here. As we gather, we acknowledge that Arlington Street Church occupies the homeland, the ancestral homeland of the Massachusetts. By making this land acknowledgement, we recognize, honor, and affirm the sovereignty of all First Nations peoples. Dear ones, welcome to our Zoomers. Welcome to the congregation gathered in person. James Foligno, you have quite a little pew with you there this morning, dear one. James has brought classmates from Cambridge School of Weston, am I right? Great, all right, welcome. Give us a wave, friends. Gabi, Soraya, Hassan, Haley. We're so thrilled you've come. James, thanks for bringing your pals. It's great, really wonderful. I also want to say thank you to all of today's winter walkers for the homeless, and I want to pay a very special welcome to our beloved Bogage family, Harriet Bogage's family. Can you all just do this? Yeah, and friends, one pew behind two. So lovely that you're here. We love her so much. We love her still. We're so glad you've come. And Dave, thank you for these beautiful Valentine's Day flowers. Harriet would have loved them. Thank you, sweetheart. Welcome, friends. It's great. This group, this esteemed group down in front is Coro Allegro. Wow, it is so amazing to have you here. Thank you so much for coming. We are really thrilled to welcome Coro Allegro, Boston's LGBTQ plus and allied classical chorus. I want to say a very special welcome to David Hodgkins, who's been conducting them beautifully for so long. Thank you, friends. Thank you for coming. In honor of Black History Month, they're gonna be singing some African American spirituals for us today. And you'll be hearing more about their upcoming concert soon. And is it possible that Jeff Fogelman's in the house? Jeff, are you here? All right, not yet. Maybe next week we will be welcoming our new church administrator. Yes, another Arlington Street miracle. We have a new administrator, and he's just lovely. He spent his week repairing bathrooms. Give him a lot of love when you see him. And finally, I want to say welcome back to Mark David. So great. Welcome back to Mark David post-COVID. And in the Zoom room, get well wishes to Reverend Beth, who is recovering from COVID. Two-thirds of the senior staff went down this week. It was not pretty. Really glad you're here, darling. Our treasurer, Liz Texera, is also in the house from New Hampshire with her wife, Dawn Balamo. Welcome, Liz. What a pleasure to see you in person, and thank you for all your service to Arlington Street. You are such a gift. We are grateful. And is that my Lauren Smith right there? My Lauren is here. Reverend Lauren Smith, one of the top brass at the UUA, but a humble Arlington Street person who went on to be ordained here and has served mightily in our association. Her husband, our Chris Jablonski, is the senior minister in our congregation in Belmont. He was John's intern supervisor. So the whole family's here this morning. I love that. Welcome, darling. And thank you to our volunteers this morning. That's John, former chair of the worship team, now getting lined up for ordination, standing in for Reverend Beth at the Gleason podium. Thanks to our greeters, to our ushers, to the tech team. Wonderful to see you this morning. The Arlington Street Church Choir, lovely to have you, dear ones. And the whole live chat coffee hour team. Coffee Hour is looking for a few more in-person people to help very occasionally with setup or take down. You can speak to me if that might be a way you'd like to give service. And let me also say, as you know, the Sparkly Spring Gala is on May 4th. Our planning team is soliciting live and silent auction items. If you can help round up or donate theater or concert tickets, tickets to sporting events, gift certificates to restaurants or spas, lessons or other great things, please see me or send me a message. And if you'd like to volunteer or be a part of any of it, we'd love it. Again, speak with me. Friends, the sanctuary is mask optional, but the ushers have mask if you change your mind. Help yourself. We're so glad you've come. For those of you who are new to Arlington Street, I want to say a very special welcome. If you're here in person, there are welcome cards in the pew racks. You can hand yours to an usher or drop it in the basket at the great doors as you leave. If you're in the Zoom room, please fill out a connection card. The link is in the chat. It includes the option to request a link to a recording of today's sermon. Since we can't greet all of you in person after the service, Reverend Beth and I would love to follow up with a virtual hello. Friends, whether you've been coming here for years or today is your first time at Arlington Street, welcome home.
Good morning.
Morning, John.
If you're here in person, there are printed copies of the order of service available at the great doors. If you're Zooming in, the order of service will appear in the chat, or you can download it on the homepage at ascboston.org. As we begin our greetings, I invite the Zoomers and those in person with a device handy to say hello in the chat and to tell us where you're Zooming in from today. And now, Michael Fisher is going to turn the camera on the in-person congregation as we wave at each other, as well as at our friends in the Zoom room, and you all in the Zoom room, wave and smile back. Hello, friends. Let's all engage that Arlington Street spirit of welcome that transcends physical distance as we greet one another heart to heart.
Good morning, everyone. Our opening hymn today is Answering the Call of Love by the Reverend Jason Shelton. The words are printed in your order of service and are available in the chat. You can also find the music in the teal hymnal number 1014, although it's by its previous title there, Standing on the Side of Love, which the composer updated for more inclusive lyrics. I invite us to rise in body, rise in spirit. Let's sing together, answering the call of love.
It is now time for our treasured ritual of sharing community candles of sorrow and joy. These candles were submitted on our website by the Friday evening deadline. If you didn't submit your candle and have a joy or sorrow to share this morning, please wait until the third candle is lit, the silent candle, and then type your joy or sorrow into the chat. Zoomers are invited to light silent candles at home. Those here in person are invited to light a silent candle at the table up front to the right of the Gleason podium. In addition to sharing our sorrows and joys this morning, let's reach out to one another in the week ahead, staying connected. May these times remind us of how very precious this beloved community is. We need one another. Whether together or to part, may we stay very close. And now, in the spirit of invocation, let's join in singing Sanctuary. The words are printed in your order of service and in the chat.
Today with heavy hearts, we open our hearts to you.
A candle of sorrow and concern from the Arlington Street community for the people of Israel and of Gaza as the Israeli government moves forward with its plans for a full-scale offensive in Rafah. A mixed candle from Doug Miller, a mixed message of sorrow and joy. Sadly, my wife, Sharon, died 20 years ago this month after suffering from cancer. Joyfully, we spent 35 years together. And our final candle of sorrow is a mixed candle from Terry and David Bogage. A mixed candle as we celebrate our mom and Nana's birthday month. We miss Harriet every day, and we know her children and grandchildren being together was her greatest joy. Love you, Mom.
Some of us come today in joy. We share your joy.
A candle of joy from Kevin Terrell. A very happy 60th birthday to my dearest husband and today's camera operator, Michael, who will reach this milestone birthday tomorrow. I'm so grateful we are sharing this life journey together. Here's to the next 60 and beyond with all my love. And a final candle of joy from Eve Loria. A candle of joy and relief that it's over for my surgery on Thursday. It went well, and I'm so glad I was able to have the minimally invasive procedure possible and that my big sister could come and support me in the hospital. I'm home recovering, but will be back as soon as I can.
Thank you.
all the sorrows and all the joys we hold in our hearts, we light a silent candle to remember and to rejoice. May the peace of this sanctuary enter into our hearts as we share a quiet moment together, breathing our prayers for ourselves, for one another, and for the world. Amen.
Let's join now in saying together the affirmation and covenant of this beloved spiritual community. The words are printed in your order of service and also in the chat. Love is the spirit of this congregation, and service is our gift. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to speak our truths in love, and to help one another. Amen. De spiritu
de nuestra congregación, y el servicio es nuestro regalo. Esto es a lo que nos comprometemos. Convivir en paz, hablar nuestras verdades con amor y ayudarnos los unos a los otros.
Hi, friends. When I first started coming to the Zoom room in January 2021, about 3 years ago, I found that the rituals which used to happen in person, greeting each other, sharing candles of sorrow and joy, singing together, had been transformed into a creative and life-affirming way. This spiritual community was using the tools of technology to build and deepen connections. I witnessed people sending love and support to each other. It was palpable. This community, the sermons, the music, it moved me to tears, pretty much every service. Not that any of you noticed, because I didn't have my camera on. It took me a while before I was ready to risk being vulnerable. I had to move at the speed of trust. This phrase, moving at the speed of trust, is a core principle from the Institute Adrienne Marie Brown co-founded. Another core principle listed there, trust the people. If you trust the people, they become trustworthy. So we're exhorted to take a leap of trust and then to use that trust to move forward. The phrase, making the path by walking, comes to mind. As a new congregant at Arlington Street back then, I was noticing both of these ideas about trust in action. Someone would share a heartfelt moment, they were trusting the people. Someone else would respond to them with love and care, moving at the speed of trust. I watched trust emerge in real time, building upon itself because you were being brave and vulnerable. So I started turning my camera on. I started reaching out to others in the chat. I began to attend virtual coffee hour, and I started volunteering. The transformation team for racial justice, the worship team, the tech team, the reverse telethon. I started building friendships across the miles. I took these leaps of trust because I had witnessed you doing it first. Well, I keep my video on now. I'm here to stay. I'm all in. And I will continue to show up with my tears, my joy, my grief, my gratitude, my witness, my love. Because I believe that the fabric of Arlington Street gets stronger each time one of us takes a leap. One way I trust the people, that is, trust us, is by supporting the community financially. I do this with joy and energy for the future. Not with any knowledge of what our future will be, but that we will continue to build it together as we go. We will make the path by walking. I trust that.
Our next hymn is hymn 1008, which you will find in the teal hymnal, When Our Heart Is in a Holy Place. Please rise as you are willing or able and join us in singing.
Recently, a young friend, married to a man with two beautiful children, emerged from a garage sale with a copy of Glennon Doyle's Untamed tucked under her arm. I buy copies to give my girlfriends who are struggling with parenting, she explained, or whose marriages are on the rocks. I laughed out loud at the part about marriages. Glennon Doyle, a best-selling Christian author, famously and very publicly propped up her serially unfaithful evangelical husband and wrote very convincingly about saving her marriage until soccer great Abby Wambach literally walked into her life, and Glennon is now Abby's wife. There's a passage in Untamed that I reflect on. It's the moment after Glennon tells the aforementioned husband that she's making her exit from their marriage. Here it is. He was very quiet, she writes. And after a long while, he said, 3 years ago, you gave me more grace than I deserved. Now I'm going to return it to you. I want you to be happy. The concept of giving someone grace, extending unearned kindness, is very powerful. I really appreciate that it doesn't get into the mire of forgiveness. Giving grace is something different. It's what American author Brad Meltzer was talking about when he said, "Everyone you meet is fighting a battle you know nothing about. Be kind. Always." Grace, it's a beautiful word. It can mean elegance or refinement or movement, as well as goodwill. It can mean unmerited favor. We speak of a grace period when we extend a deadline. Grace is a disposition to compassion. Grace, from the Latin via Old French via Middle English word meaning grateful. Giving someone grace doesn't mean excusing bad behavior. It's not about them. It's about us. Giving grace only means extending compassion. Compassion is probably another sermon, but let's just give it a beat. Science tells us that practicing compassion produces 100% more DHEA, which is a hormone that counteracts the aging process, and 23% less cortisol, the stress hormone. People who are compassionate and those around them are happier. And there's nothing stunning about those conclusions. Being judgmental and bearing grudges really eats up a lot of mental and emotional energy. There's a great teaching tale from American spiritual leader Ram Dass, a story he told on himself. Years ago, he said, "I went to a silent meditation retreat, a 10-day course, and I had a roommate. We couldn't speak to each other because silent. The corners on his sheets were all neat on his bed, and his clothes were all lined up. I was a little sloppy. Neatness is not my particular preoccupation." He says, "I started to feel that he was thinking I was a real slob, and he didn't like me. And I was probably snoring and disturbing him, and I got to feeling actually that he really hated me. You know, within the silence, you can play with such wonderful paranoia. And I just decided, I mean, by the end of it, I hated him for hating me." So we came out of the retreat, and the first thing he said to me, the first thing was, "I cannot tell you what an honor it's been sharing this room with you, Ram Dass." And I just thought, oh, expletive. I wasted hours being absolutely convinced he hated me, filling my consciousness with it for 10 days when I could have been getting enlightened. Sometimes we have to extend grace to ourselves. If we struggle with giving grace, there's a spiritual practice that can help. It's called the commonality practice. You could even try it right now. You can focus your attention on someone or something that has wronged you and just run this sequence. Just like me, they are seeking happiness. Just like me, they are trying to avoid suffering. Just like me, they are sometimes sad and lonely. Just like me, they are trying to get their needs met. Just like me, they are a work in progress. Giving grace lifts everyone. Ram Dass said, treat everyone you meet like God in drag. Women's leadership coach, Dr. Margie Worrell, tells the story of attending a dinner where a waiter accidentally poured wine into someone's water glass. He realized immediately what he had done. He apologized profusely. He made it right. Nonetheless, this woman's displeasure overflowed, and she let him know it. Much later, as they were finishing their meal, the waiter returned and apologized again. I'm currently being treated for a tumor on my brain, he said. Sometimes I don't think very clearly, but I have to keep working. I need the money. The woman felt terrible. She expressed her sympathy and wished him well. But wouldn't it have been lovely if she could have gotten to grace a little sooner? Giving grace. We can show up with the very qualities we like to see more of in each other. When they go low, say it with me, we go high. Again, giving grace doesn't mean tolerating the intolerable or not holding bad behavior to account, especially bad behavior from those whom we entrust with competence and character. Giving grace means being faster to listen, slower to judge, willing to imagine exchanging places. American author Anne Lamott writes, I do not at all understand the mystery of grace, only that it meets us where we are, but does not leave us where it found us. I'm going to close with a story by MacArthur Fellow and author of Middle Passage, Charles R. Johnson. He opens the story by quoting the conclusion of a Rasmussen Report survey that 69% of Americans think the United States has become ruder and less civilized. And then he includes this from Lebanese-American writer and artist Khalil Gibran. This is for you, Khala. I have learned silence from the talkative, toleration from the intolerant, and kindness from the unkind. Yet strange I am ungrateful to those teachers. The trouble started one evening in September, Charles Johnson begins. It was around 6 o'clock, and I was sitting on one of the trees in my backyard, watching a brace of pigeons splash wildly in our stone bird bath, beneath which a stone head of the Buddha rose up from the grass. I've always loved this hour of the day when the spill of afternoon light, so ethereal, filters through old-growth trees in Wedgwood. A neighborhood of gentle slopes, gentle hills, a quiet, hidden oasis within Seattle, inhabited mainly by college professors and older, retired people. Here, you never feel you're in a big city with all those big city problems. I sat in a lazy lotus posture, the four fingers on each hand tipped against my thumbs. Behind me, floating on an almost hymnal silence, a few soothing notes sounded from the wood chimes hanging from my house, accompanied by bird flutter and the rustle of leaves. I began to slowly drift into meditation, hoping today would bring at least a tidbit of spiritual discovery. But no sooner than I'd closed my eyes and felt the outside world fall away, the air was shattered by a hair-raising explosion of music booming from stereo speakers somewhere nearby, like a volcano exploding. Now, I love music, he continues, especially soft jazz. But this was heavy metal, techno pounding at 120 decibels, alternating with acid rock and sprinkled with gangster rap that sounded to my ears like rhymed shouting. The neighborhood shook with a tsunami of inquietude. Its energy was 5 billion times greater than that from the wood chimes. Our new neighbors. 1 or 2 hours went by. There was no escaping the bass beat that reverberated in my bones, the energy of the shrill profanity and angry lyrics. Wave upon wave, the pulsations came from across the street, intrusive, infectious, jangling, surrounding my home like a hand squeezing a wine glass on the verge of shattering. And now, suddenly, I was having a bad day. Walking into the house, I saw my wife coming down the stairs, wearing her round reading glasses and looking dazed. She started shutting all the windows, but that didn't help. The sound curdled the air inside our house. "What do you think we should do?" I asked. "Call 911? "Oh no," she said, "they're just kids. We were kids once, remember?" Then suddenly her lips pouted and she looked hurt. "Why are you shouting at me?" Was I shouting? "Yes," she said, "you were yelling at me." I didn't realize how much I'd raised my voice in order to be heard over the mind-blaring music outside. She was, after all, only 2 feet away from me. Or that noise, despite all my decades of spiritual practice, could so quickly make me feel spent and flammable. I was no longer myself, though I suspected this was a teachable moment. So help me, I just wasn't getting it. I apologized to my wife. I knew she was right, as usual. We shouldn't call the police. Still, I wondered, who are these rude people, these invaders? I decided this was a good time to go shopping. With my wife's list of groceries, including a chocolate cake to celebrate the birthday of one of her friends at Mount Zion Baptist Church, I fled into the night, or more precisely, to the supermarket. As I put half a mile between myself and Ground Zero, as the pitch declined, I felt less agitated, though there was a slight ringing and seashell sound in my ears, lingering like a low-grade fever. Compared to my street, the supermarket was mercifully quiet. I bagged the groceries in paper, that would prove to be a big mistake, and hurried across the street to the drugstore to buy earplugs. Driving home, I was praying the neighbor's party was over, but even though my ears were plugged, I felt the density in the air before I heard the humping arc still flooding the neighborhood like a broken sewer main. Even worse, when I downshifted into my driveway, I had to hit the brakes because one of my neighbor's guests had parked there, a Chevy Blazer with an obscene bumper sticker. My first impulse was to let the air out of the tires, but then I realized it would only keep it there longer. So I parked 2 blocks away, loaded up my arms as high as my chin with 4 heavy bags of food, and that's when the big, fat raindrops began to fall. By the time I was 30 feet from my front door, the paper bags were soaking wet and falling apart. And sure enough, one began to give way, sending cans of sliced pineapples, rice, a bottle of maple syrup, tomatoes, milk, potatoes, and a bag of raisins, cascading down the driveway, littering the street like confetti or a landfill. For the longest time, I stood there, sopping wet, watching my neighbor's guests flee inside to escape the rain, lost in the whirl of violent, invisible vibrations. And I was disabused forever of the vanity that 3 decades of practicing meditation had made me too civilized, too cultivated, or somehow immune to anger, desire, self-pity, pettiness. These would always arise, I saw, even without noise pollution. And then all at once, the music stopped. I slogged across the street, so tired I couldn't see straight. I climbed my new neighbor's stairs and banged on the front door with my fist. After a moment, it opened. Standing before me was possibly the most physically fit young man I had ever seen, young enough to be my son. His hair was a military buzz cut, his t-shirt olive colored, his ears large enough for him to wiggle if he wanted to. And on his arm, I saw a tattoo for the 4th Brigade of the 2nd Infantry Division he had served with. He looked me up and down as I stood dripping on his doorstep and asked politely, "Yes, sir, can I help you?" "We need to talk," I said. He squinted his eyes as if trying to read my lips. Then he put one hand behind his ear, like an old, old man who had lost his hearing aid. "What did you say, sir?" I was less than a foot away from him. I felt as if I were coming to from a dream. A profound sadness swept over me, dousing my anger. Before me stood the unnecessary tragedy of hearing loss, maybe the result of a recent tour in Iraq or Afghanistan, maybe from an IED. I was humbled. I did not judge him or myself now, because he had just taught me to listen better. I gestured with one finger held up for him to wait a moment and went back into the downpour. On the street, I found what I was looking for, grateful that its plastic lid had kept it from being ruined by the rain. I climbed the steps. "Thank you," I said, giving him the chocolate cake. "Welcome to Wedgwood." Beloved spiritual companions, we cannot understand the mystery of grace, only that it meets us where we are, but does not leave us where it found us. Everyone we meet is fighting a battle we know nothing about. May we treat everyone like God in drag. Let us give one another grace, remembering to include ourselves. Be kind. Always. Amen.
thank you to Coro Allegro. That was absolutely beautiful. Arlington Street is entirely self-sustaining. It's up to us. And as you heard this morning, our generation continues to be astounding. Thank you for your commitment to our staff, our building, and to our beloved spiritual community. Each Sunday, we share a collection plate with a partner in our mission of love, service, justice, and peace. Today, our beneficiary is Renewal House. Run by the Unitarian Universalist Urban Ministry, Renewal House provides temporary emergency shelter and advocacy services to individuals and families escaping domestic violence. You can read much more about their life-saving work in the Order of Service. For the past 34 years, Arlington Street has been my spiritual home. In stormy times, it has been a place of shelter. I remember in 1990, standing at this very podium, offering my very first candle. I was shaking with rage. A group of us had just attended an AIDS fundraiser in the South End and were attacked by a gang wielding broken bottles and bats, screaming anti-gay slurs. Several ended up in the hospital with serious injuries, and so I, a lawyer, ended up as a witness in a federal hate crimes trial. And Arlington Street Church was there. Arlington Street has been a community of joy and celebration for me. I never expected to be a bride in a traditional church wedding. Well, sort of traditional. And Arlington Street has been a community of learning, where I have been challenged to become the best possible version of myself. Whoever would have thought that an angry young lawyer who came up to this podium 34 years ago would later decide to go to divinity school to study ministry? For those of you new to Arlington Street Church, stick around. There's magic in this place. Please take a moment now to join me in giving to our beloved spiritual community in filling our virtual collection plate. You can give online by scanning the QR code in the order of service. Go to the ASCBoston.org, text your gift or Venmo at Arlington Street. If you're Zooming, you can even mail a check to the church. If you're in person, please use the envelopes in the pews, which can be handed to Reverend Kim, to me, or to any of the ushers after the service. Thank you so much for your generosity.
Are you the one?
Thank you again, Coro Allegro. And thanks to Marie O'Brien for highlighting her beautiful sharing today, All In. Covenant Renewal Sunday, when we renew our great covenant of love and service and make pledges to support the work of this beloved community, is coming up on March 3rd, so mark your calendars. There are weekly gatherings in the Arlington Street Zoom room for loving kindness meditation, poetry, yoga, and writing. If you like to sing, the Arlington Street Choir welcomes you to come rehearse in person on Thursday evenings. No experience necessary. This week on Tuesday evening, Reverend Kim hosts Buddha's Belly Book Group and the Arlington Street Meditation Center. Every Wednesday at 4, Reverend Kim and Reverend Beth host a tea party with a conversation prompt. This week's prompt is, what makes your heart sing? For Black History Month, today's guest musicians, Coro Allegro, invite those of you in the Boston area to their concert at 3 p.m. next Sunday afternoon. Identity, I Believe. The program will feature works by trailblazing Black composers performed in concert with acclaimed Black LGBTQ+ and allied guest artists. Arlington Street members and friends will receive a lovely discount. And our own Beck Zier is in concert with Lilith Ensemble this coming Saturday and Sunday evening. Next Sunday's concert is right here in the Hunnewell Chapel. For all these concerts and offerings, information and Zoom links are available at ascboston.org. To attend any Zoom meetings or gatherings, you don't have to be a member. You don't have to turn on your video or talk if you don't want to. And best of all, they're all free. All are always welcome. Following the service, everyone is welcome to join the virtual coffee hour. If you'd like to participate, join the Arlington Street Zoom room and answer yes to the breakout room invitation that will appear on your screen. If you're here in person, following the service, we'll gather in the Hunnewell Chapel for a live chat coffee hour right through the leather door to the right of the pulpit. Thanks to all of you who joined in today's service and to all those who made it possible, especially Coro Allegro. Remember, we're all in this together. I love you.
Thanks, John. Our final hymn today is number 205, Amazing Grace. I invite us to rise in body, rise in spirit, and sing together.
Save the soul like
Benediction, I invite those of you in the Zoom room to please reach out your hands and touch the sides of your Hollywood Square. Those of you in the sanctuary to please raise your hands, palms out, and let's send loving kindness to the people to your left and to your right. Send loving kindness to people on either side of you, people all through this whole sanctuary and beyond, through this beloved spiritual community. Feel it coming back to you. Love is the spirit of this congregation. And now for our benediction, I'm going to invite you to put your hands over your heart in namaste. I bow to the divine in you. Adapted from the words of Judy Chicago. And then compassion will be wedded to power. And then softness will come to a world that is harsh and unkind. And then all will be gentle and all will be strong. And then the greed of some will give way to the needs of many. And then all will share equally in the earth's abundance. And then all will cherish earth's creatures. And then everywhere will be called Eden once again. Let us keep this faith, beloveds, and pass it on. The service begins when the service ends. Bless your hearts. I love you. Amen.
please visit ascboston.org for more information about this historic Unitarian Universalist congregation. Arlington Street Church, gathered in love and service for justice and peace.